the Chamorros on Guam number only 39%. 39%. And even if they voted for some other status, not enough to carry. Because there are many different races, many different people here on Guam.
I am really proud that I was able to be a Marine. If I had it to do over again, of course I would. But looking at this place right now, how beautiful it is, how peaceful it is, hard to envision that it was a site of such, you know, bloodshed, violence. You know, kids that you look at today, 17, 18, 19 years old, and, well, those guys were your fighting Marines back during World War II.
Japan launched a devastating surprise air attack on Pearl Harbor, which destroyed much of America's Pacific Fleet. In a flash, the Japanese gained the upper hand in what would become the war in the Pacific. A few hours after the fateful strike at Pearl Harbor, the Japanese assaulted Wake Island, the Philippines, and Guam. On Guam, across the international dateline, it was Monday, December 8th. The Chamorros found themselves captives in their own land. Within hours of the invasion, Agaña was an armed camp. The Plaza de España became a temporary military administration center. There, Chamorros were assembled at bayonet point and forced to register.
I met a group of army soldiers, 77th Army. These were big, huge guys. They were part of a crew, army men cleaning up stragglers. So I volunteered. You know, I was out to get myself some savage, okay? So I joined them, we started marching. Then I noticed on my left, a big hole, a bokongo. Have you heard of the word bokongo? This is an underground shelter. It's a relatively large bokongo. And then I heard movement. And before I knew it, a hand grenade flew out. I just had enough time to hit the ground. A partial brick, part of the hand grenade shrapnel hit me. And I went down. They carried me to the jeep. They went over to the field hospital in Ta'i, where I was operated, and then taken down to Aniwek for my recovery.
The word liberation, you are being, it's not a nice word. I mean, you are being liberated. It's a nice word, I guess, when it's used properly, okay?
Each of them had a story, and each of those victims are a victim because of something. Of what they believed, and you know, they were killed for their independence or their defiance or for whatever reason. So that's, I think, the most important part. So it's hard pressed to say this is the one thing. You can't really put a finger on that. That's why when I address people about liberation, I say every July that starts the liberation motion of that. But you know, the war really didn't just end on July 21. It went all the way to August 10th, I believe, and then even further down the line as the rebuilding efforts and everything, there was still that, you know, the world was still at war. The war didn't end until 1945.
It's something unusual. To me, it's something unusual to see 1, 2, 3 planes at one time. So there must be something wrong.
The Chamorros were celebrating the island's most revered festival, the Feast of the Immaculate Conception. The Agaña Cathedral was crowded with celebrants,
all of a sudden I was distracted by these people coming in from all the doors and whispering to people. There must be their relatives.
The message spreading terror in Chamorro hearts was that Sumai had been bombed by the Japanese. Bishop Olano ended the mass early. People prayed, then ran, like Barcy Frankes.
I was running too because I heard war, war, war.
It was December 8, 1941. Pearl Harbor, Hawaii had been bombed only hours before. Guam, America's other Pacific territory, was Japan's next stop. The pilots knew their targets, the military installations around Apra Harbor at Petey and Sumai. America had not fortified Guam against possible attack. Military personnel numbered only 600. There were few guns.
I was 7 years old when the Japanese occupied Guam. And the experience I had during the war was, I can start off by saying that I actually was already starting kindergarten, the American school. With I remember very vividly Mrs. Agigi, who was then my kindergarten teacher. And then, of course, on a Sunday morning, when we were going to church, there was something unusual happened, which as a young kid, I'm not totally cognizant or aware of what this, what was really going on, except that people were screaming, crying, and saying that we, this is an agate, and saying that we were being invaded.
Liberation Day is really a day to honor and celebrate our greatest generation, our war survivors, our Manumco. And why is it important? It serves as a solemn reminder that we should always, in our power, do everything we can to preserve peace and to always choose peace over war.
He told the people that after the planes would leave, for us to hurry home. So my sister and I were running out, and everybody was screaming and running and acting really crazy.
It turned 2,000 degrees from what it was. A very peaceful, a very quiet locality, into a very warlike situation, completely changed over. I mean, you could imagine what the changes were.
Of the 7,000 invasion troops, there were 700 in each of the first waves of the Naval Special Landing Force. They were outfitted for resistance. Cautiously, they left their boats and pushed up the beach to a stand of coconut palms. They waited. The Japanese invasion troops met few people on the road that morning, but those they did meet died.
You know, when you lose your freedom and your dignity, you go through life just, what is it? What do you say? Just living day to day.
The Japanese converted the cathedral and other buildings around the Plaza de España into prisons for captured American military personnel, insular force guardsmen, and civilians.
Suddenly, screaming, the Japanese began storming the plaza, lining everyone up, forcing them to disrobe, including the governor. A machine gun was aimed at the men. No one moved. No one dared speak. The injured laid on the ground before the line of men. Ben Chargaloff moaned, holding his bloody right arm, which hung only by shreds of skin.
The fact that our people not just feared for their lives, but they felt very uncertain about where their next meal would be. They felt very uprooted from their lives. I want them to reflect liberation as a close relationship with our U.S. partners in the future. I want us to be able to live together in a very diverse cultural environment, but also to strengthen and also to continue on our legacies as a Chamorro culture, and never losing that.
The Army harshly enforced a host of new rules. It severely punished even minor infractions. A public execution was conducted. Most contacts between the Chamorros and the Japanese were during forced labor, done under strict guard.
So we were told to bow to the emperor, but I refused. So I always left. So I attended for more than a year. So I think I was in the third grade. Japanese, speak a little Japanese. Then 1942, then we were asked to work for the Japanese. I was 12 years old. So I started working at the NAS again, at the Tijan, what we call now Tijan. And my job there was to serve.
My brother, Juan, the oldest brother, and my sister, Rita, were being forced to work in the rice paddies around the agate surrounding area.
We were shoveling up some coral on a diesel truck that was quite high for me. I was 15 only. So I couldn't reach the top, and a Japanese, I think it's Korean or Japanese, come right back and start scolding me and hit me on the back with the steel shovel on my back. And I really got injured up to this time.
If they're not satisfied with our work, they will tell us to line up face to face and slap one another.
At the boss, Okinawan, met us. We stood at attention. Three of us, I don't know where I was, but three of us, one, two, three, four.
As I said before, that feeling of losing your freedom and your dignity, there wasn't much life there but to hope for whatever would be coming later on.
They told us to march to Meningen, so we had to leave everything behind and march from Barigara. We walk up to Meningen. So when we arrive in Meningen, of course there was no water except the riverbank. I don't know if you've been to that Meningen, but the riverbank. So what we did there was dig a trenches so that where we can sleep, you know. We cannot sleep on our. So we dig us trenches.
So on my Chinorio side, they were marched to Meningen and listening or hearing the recollections of my dad's siblings, you know, at the river, seeing bodies floating down the river. I just can't imagine how all of them reconciled that, right? And live life after that, but they did, and it just showed how strong they were.
John Garcia remembers the skimpy shelters in which they lived in Meningen. He and 10,000 other Chamorros had been force marched here by the Japanese early in July 1944.
Very miserable. Some of them died on the way. I know that when I met a lady, a family, and grandma was holding a dead baby on her arms. Really? It was. And then when we were in the camp, Meningen, my cousin's wife died up there. There are many. My husband's auntie died in my arms. She was so old.
The information says that they're starting massacring people of Guam from the southern, Yumarag, Risho. And that's when we got more scared. So the Japanese still posted about several machine guns, and nobody can leave that. And my job there, I was 14 years old, I can still remember some, you know, to get water from the river, and you wash your clothes in the river, because there's no running water.
Yeah, but that's dirty water.
I know, but we boil it. So then the information said that the American landed in July 21, 1944.
As the Chamorros huddled in their shelters, they could feel the results of what they now suspected was a full-blown American invasion. The American invasion included 13 days of pre-bombardment, the most systematically conducted naval bombardment in the war to that date.
Within a short span of time, a lot of things happened, but you know, from December 8, 1941, many Chamorros died, and then Chamorros died in between all that, and then the 21st was that kind of moment of this is what's happened here, and then it was just that effect of on that. So the rebuilding of Guam and who was here, and you know, like I said, every part of the Pacific experienced some part of this war, and they're still feeling the effects of it.
My feeling now for the U.S. is, well, it's the liberation that really counts. The U.S. is part of our life. It's the United States of America is part of our life. They started out to establish Guam in 1898, right after the Spanish-American War. And I feel much better comfortable, freedom of expression, freedom of everything that you can move on. And I look forward for more about the freedom and this education for the children of our island. And that is provided by the United States of America.
Off Guam's coast was the largest armada gathered in the Pacific to that point. Made up of task forces 53 and 58, it had grown powerfully and inexorably from the wreckage of Pearl Harbor. All that, plus more than 50,000 men, determined to liberate Guam. It began with a pre-invasion bombardment at 5:30 a.m., July 21st. Some 3 hours later, landings began as the 3rd Marine Division, along with the U.S. Coast Guard, hit Asan's northern beaches. Shortly thereafter, the 1st Provisional Marine Brigade, later followed by the Army's 77th Infantry Division, arrived on Agate's beaches to the south.
The soldiers called for a halt in the artillery barrage. The man identified himself as a Chamorro and told the soldiers of lots of people in a camp in the valley. Smith volunteered for the patrol, which was formed to bring the Chamorros out.
It was the most pathetic sight I think I've ever seen. There was old men and women and young children and women with babies with sores and flies all over. They were thin, underfed, and just pathetic looking.
Today, at his home in Newton, New Jersey, Smith says the people's reaction to them is something he will never forget.
When they saw us, that's when they ran over and they grabbed us, they shook hands and they cried and they laughed.
It's a hectic time. Only just think that we always pray. We pray to God. We don't know where He is, but He is.
Released from the concentration camps by Marines and soldiers of the 77th Infantry Division, the Chamorros were overcome with emotion.
I even hugged one and I kissed him. I said, thank God I did see you people. And I was crying. I was crying when I touched them. I was so grateful.
They wanted to give us things. They had eggs or maybe a chicken, a scrawny chicken or something. Anything they had, they came over and gave us a piece of cloth, just anything.
They were yelling, crying, you know, saying, gracias a Dios, meaning God's mercy, and all that. And they said, thanks God, Dios mercy.
It was, oh, you would just have to be there to see and to remember how it in your heart, feel it.
Through the eyes of a 24-year-old woman who lost her father and her groom-to-be, big, tall, stately Americans, somebody said to me, the Americans have landed and I think we're going to be liberated. And somebody pointed to the mountain in Manyengun and they said, that was where the first group came down. And so I said, I don't know what you people saw, but through the eyes of a 24-year-old woman, those people that were coming down there were neither Marines, Navy, Army, or anything. To me, they looked like Greek gods.
These people were strung out for a couple miles, going up this hill, just helping each other, and the soldiers and the men in the patrol helping the old people. And as we got near the bivouac area, the fellas ran out from the camp, and they helped the men and the women and the children, and they gave them cigarettes and candy, and it was just like an old home week, a reunion. Just happy, just so happy to be free again.
Oh, they were happy. They were happy. I'm telling you, they were happy. They don't care. They don't care what they carry there. They just left them. Let's run. They run, and all of my girls.
People will never know how free they are until they lose that freedom, and I lose that, or we lost that freedom once.
I keep telling my kids, enjoy the freedom that you have. Maintain your dignity, because without freedom and without dignity, you are nothing. You are absolutely nothing. You know, you're just somebody that's been moving around. But I keep telling them, no matter what you do in life, enjoy this freedom. The United States might not be the perfect country, but to me, it's the best. And I keep telling my kids, do not take it for granted, because you never know how great it is until it's been taken away from you by force.
You know, otherwise, you know, we're taking the freedom for granted. I'm pretty sure that people during the wartime occupation would have loved to just have the freedom to clean up after themselves, to be able to walk around, you know, go to the beach. But they were living in fear for 2.5 years, you know. Many of them beaten, tortured, some of them killed. So we're lucky that we don't have that experience. We better then make the most of our time and get into action. Yeah.
We never returned to Melissa. Everybody stayed out in the farms. The Japanese took over a few of the buildings in Melissa. And of course, people in general tried to avoid the Japanese.
Sumai residents also did not return to their village, but they had no choice. They were ordered not to.
Right after the invasion by the Japanese, and I go back to my town of Sumai, I couldn't hear anything but silence. It's a ghost town. It's a very bad feeling. And I was with my father at the time, and he says, son, if I'm going to tear any part of this house and we're going to rehabilitate ourselves up at upper heights, I'd rather burn it. Because everything, it's hard.
People were in New York, thousands of people. I mean, you know, not much facilities, very uncomfortable for the Samoros. And my father just wanted to get out of there. So he managed, against advice from the military people running Aniguac, not to go home, because there were still stragglers around the island. Reports were coming in that they were being killed. Not many were taken prisoners. the Chamorros, there was a group formed right after the invasion of Chamorros, young Chamorros, to go search for stragglers and bring them in for questioning. They didn't bring in a single stragglers. Nobody whom they encountered lived.
Even now, I'm patriotic to the extent of whenever I hear that Star-Spangled Banner playing in television or in appeared in radio, I have chills all over me up to this day. I don't know whether you call that patriotism, but I'm saying I did my best for my country.
I try to imagine, although very difficult, the suffering and the struggles that our family and everyone's families had to go through during that period of time. And as a result of that, when I think of all of that, and I also read and see stories about the U.S. Armed Forces coming to our waters and to our space to save our people, it just gives me a great feeling of humility and a great feeling of appreciation and gratification for those individuals that also sacrifice their lives to save the lives of our people. And so liberation means to me that people's lives were saved and were protected. And it also meant a rebuilding of our world after an atrocious war. So it means freedom to me. It means peace to me. It means a relief of anxiety and stress for our people. And it means the beginning of a great new world for our people.
I would like to build, to see, and to live in a more compassionate, a more prosperous, a more fair, and a more safe Guam. I'd like to see a Guam that embraces the spirit of Inafat Malik. That same spirit that has earned us the admiration and the respect of those visitors that come to Guam and those people who are not from Guam. There's just something unique about the people from Guam. And I truly believe that uniqueness is that spirit of Inafat Malik. And I believe, you know, we would truly be liberated if we can pass that spirit of Inafat Malik to the generations to come.